Okay, so what we have here is in the southwest corner of the map. Because north is the top of the map for this game. So in the southwest corner, we see sort of the initial approaches here of the Germans and their initial setup. The scenario has pretty rigid setup, at least for the 8th Panzer. This is where the 8th Panzer units that you start with, they're always located there. The 3rd Motorized is hanging out up here. You can either start that grouping in this hex, or you can choose to go to this hex. And the reason that's like an interesting choice is because there's this stream here. If you'll notice right there's no bridge except for over here. If you start here, then it allows you to kind of jump to the northern road, which I'll show in a minute. It's easier, because otherwise I have to spend, oh goodness, I have to spend 3 movement just to get here for anybody with a red box movement, which is everybody in the stack, which we'll look at in just a second. That would be 3 movement points, because it takes one to cross the stream, one to enter a hex that's got woods and clear. So it was actually two there, one to cross the stream, 3 total. So starting them here gives you the advantage of being able to get that northern road much in a much quicker fashion, as opposed to being down here, in which case you're probably going to commit yourself to the southern road. And you might ask yourself, well, isn't that choice obvious? If obviously the northern road is where we have victory conditions that I'll show, and you need to go up there to harass anyway, why would you ever start down here? Well, as you'll see, the Soviet reinforcements come from both the north and the south, and perhaps you want to focus most of the 3rd Motorized efforts down in the south, and maybe take elements of the 8th Panzer and move them north. You have a lot of choices there, and this really is one of those little minor but very important choices as to what kind of overall campaign you're hoping to have in the battle. While I'm here talking about this, I think maybe it's a good time to talk about what historically happened here. That's the one of the nice things about this game is that Vance von Boris and probably his whoever helped produce the game, I need to look that up so I can give proper credit, did a lot of historical notes about it. And of course, this is part of the, geez, what is it? The drive on Leningrad. So it's Army Group North operations. And essentially, what happened for the Battle of Soltsy was this: is that this was part of a renewed drive on Leningrad, and the 8th Panzer and the 3rd Motorized and other elements were tasked with taking what were essentially the south and eastern approaches to Leningrad, which included Soltsy, and then also Shimsk. What happened essentially was that as these units came along this road and worked their way up to Soltsy and Shimsk, Soviet command kind of noticed that they were becoming overextended and pretty much shoestring-like extended out. And in fact, if you look at the reinforcements, you get a sense of that sort of shoestringness happening because your rear echelons come in later and they're not grouped together, and it would have made more of an impact had they been able to come more on time. But instead, what you see is sort of this slow progression up the road. And historically, what happened was the Soviet command let the 8th Panzer and the 3rd Motorized kind of motor up the road. The 3rd Motorized went up here to take Gorodishche, which is the sort of green marker there. They were engaged on this northern road while the 8th Panzer motored their way up to Soltsy. And what happened was they got around Soltsy, and then elements of, as we'll see over here on the reinforcements, here, let's take a look at the reinforcements. So you have elements of the 183rd there, the 237th, and the 180th. And what happened was that the 237th came down from the north and engaged the 3rd Motorized, attacking them several times in one day around Gorodishche. So it pretty much kept the motorized pinned here. And then elements of the 70th, and then the 21st Tanks, which have not entered the board yet, came around Soltsy along with other sort of cobbled together infantry units that came, well, let's move that down here from the south, and they came up. And what they did is they effectively encircled the Soviet or German forces that were centered on Soltsy. The Germans spent a few days furiously counterattacking before they were able to escape out west, and they eventually came down here and were relieved by other German forces in the area because their attack was essentially a failure and was repulsed. Essentially, this game only models 5 days, and the battle itself was not, particularly long. But its importance was the fact that it bought Leningrad several key weeks of defensive planning, able to get troops in, able to think about what was going to happen, buying time for the city. As we all know, it suffered mightily under its 3-year siege. So while this may seem like sort of a minor battle, and indeed the scenario only covers what is a total of 5 days of time, these sort of delaying actions were proved that not only Could you stop the Germans? In fact, this is one of the first battles in which the German Panzer Force had been repulsed by the Soviet forces. But it also showed that you would do almost anything to get more time for the city, because it wasn't really a foregone conclusion that the Germans were going to lose at this point, of course. And you could see definitely that buying time for your key cities was something that, of course, that the Stavka really wanted. That's a really pretty fairly obvious. And this game is one of those minor battles that sort of adds up in a bigger picture. And that's why it's really fun to play, because you're like, wow, this actually did have importance. You know, not every battle is just a clash of giant forces. Sometimes the very minor battles, minor conflicts, really do prove decisive in the end. So that was kind of the historical occurrence of what happened. Yeah, sort of what happened in my last game is I sort of followed what the historical occurrence was. I took elements of the Third Motorized here, and more will come on the board. In fact, let's take a look at the old Russian or Soviet, German reinforcements here. So you can see we've got much more of the 8th Panzer coming on within 2 turns, and then of course lots of the 3rd Motorized show up. So what I did essentially was, I in my last game, I took the elements of 3rd Motorized here, I zoomed up, I sort of tried to outflank these guys by coming around the sort of the center gap and also up there, and this forced them to push back. But of course this one stubborn unit up here held back, secured the supply line. I wasted a couple of turns and lost a couple of steps trying to remove them from there before the Third Motorized could press over here. And by then, the trap was beginning to be sprung on my forces around Soltsy, because the 8th Panzer had sort of motored up here. Fairly easily took Soltsy, but it was becoming heavily defended. And at that point, it was just, you know, getting surrounded, and I had to pull out. And by then, my momentum was totally lost. I was never able to drive past Soltsy. And actually was pushed back all the way past Sitnia, and I was able to retake it, and that pretty much secured the win. But it was very close, and a very key blunder was I left some very powerful artillery for the Soviets. I was afraid that the Germans were going to actually take Utrogorsk up here, so I brought the artillery up there. They never made any kind of headway up there, and instead it really came down to the decisive Battle of Sitnia, which I used ill-equipped forces without the proper artillery. This game, we're going to try to do something a little different. We'll see how it develops. It is a very tough puzzle for the Germans to crack. Historically, they didn't know they were motoring into a trap, and that's what gave the Soviets an incredible advantage. Here, you know where they're coming, but because the tempo and the fact that you have to get certain cities on a time scale, you know, on a very restricted time scale, time frame, that's the pressure. You know, that's the problem. You know you have better forces, but can you execute properly, and can you get the goals? The designer and his suggestions for the scenario says that you should take these sort of advanced elements of the 8th Panzer, you know, skip Soltsy altogether, and just head for Shimsk and start taking these VPXs. Of course, the 70th is right there, and it's a formidable force, as you can see. So you have to be very creative in order to get to some of these places. I looked at those, you know, designer suggestions, and they must be much better players than me, because that seems very daunting to just sort of put yourself out of supply willingly, at least for a turn, until your other elements of the 8th Panzer can come in and sort of mop up behind you. I mean, that's pretty awesome play. So maybe I'll try that. I don't know. I mean, I'm not the best battlefield commander. I think many people who play war games would never claim themselves to be new Napoleons or whatnot. But this game does reward movement. It does reward sort of extending yourself, and I'm feeling like maybe I should try that more in this game. I was a little more conservative in my last game. I still got the German win, but it could have been much. I could have had more breathing room. So I definitely need to work harder at either taking out HQs and artilleries. I guess this is a good time to talk about some of the special rules of this scenario, because we're here. Oh, that's my dog. Let me take a look at something. I'll be right back. All right, apologies. Having dogs in the house means sometimes you gotta take care of them when other dogs walk by the window. Anyway, so let's talk a little bit about the special rules for this scenario, because there are a couple of them. They're not extensive, but they sort of help to instill the flavor of what actually happened here at the Battle of Soltsy. So one of the big ones, of course, is at the 70th, which I've shown you up here many times now. To show their relative disorganization, you don't even get an activation marker for them until the 14 a.m. turn. So there's all the units you get, and boom, there's the activation marker. And as you can see on the turn track here, I mean, 14 a.m. is 2 turns away. So for 2 turns, in 2 entire turns, these guys just sit here. It's kind of frustrating. Got some 6.54 infantry there, some good forces here, and all they do is sit there. Some other restrictions, of course, can't just be that you lose a good portion of your forces to an activity. There has to be more. Let's see, the airfield over here by Soltsy. Let's go ahead and put our forces on Soltsy for a second. So the airfield there, if the Germans take it, and they are indeed surrounded, they can trace supply to the airfield as long as it's not a rain turn, and they can supply 2 hexes of units. They don't supply artillery. If you fire artillery and you can't supply them through the normal supply rules and you're using the airfield, they don't flip over. In my last game, I fortified that area and held it, but it was just too scary and daunting being surrounded by Soviet units at all sides that I didn't hold out and really utilize the airfield. It could definitely become handy if you get captured or sort of encircled and you're desperately needing supply for a couple of your panzer group together in hexes. But, that's an interesting rule, and it definitely comes in handy, and maybe if you hold out longer in Soltsy, that's definitely going to be very helpful. But anyway, airfield does that for you there. Let's see, there's some other Soviet disorganization rules. So we have, So right now we're looking at the 202nd Rifle Division here. This is most of their forces around Soltsy. And for the 13 AM and PM, so for the first two turns, they can only have 2 units max stack in a hex. So we don't follow the sort of 9 rule that you have in hexes. The only 2 of their units, including the HQ, can only stack in a hex, which means as the Germans sort of push up to Soltsy, you're not going to be able to get a really focused defense in one hex. You really have to spread out. And I also take that rule to mean that other units can't stack with them, because you do get some reinforcements that can motor down the road. But I'm guessing these rules also mean that no one else can stack with them. At least that's how I played last time. I guess I should probably ask and see if that's a clarification. I sort of assume that, hey, if they're so disorganized they can't stack with each other, how could any other unit, you know, also be in that hex justifiably and not be disorganized or not have a problem, you know? So for the first 2 turns, only 2 possible max stacking, which was a terrible way to phrase that. Okay, the other thing you get is the 3rd Soviet tank, which is sort of the ones that are around Sydney in the beginning. So that little green marker, I have them all over the map. Those represent victory point locations. They're a little visual reminder for me as the German player where I need to drive to. So as you can see there where the green marker is, that's Sydney. It's also where a lot of the 3rd Soviet tank division is. Well, the HQ and the motorized battalion, they can't move on the 13 AM. So where's the HQ? Actually, he's up here. So the HQ cannot move during the 13 a.m. turn. And the artillery that is right there stays fired. So it doesn't even get to flip over. So that's awesome. There's another artillery here that also stays flipped over or starts flipped over. So you're also kind of denied some really good artillery the first turn. There's also motorized battalions, is it? Yeah, these people can't move either, so that's really wonderful. That's a motorized battalion you got there. It's a what? I think a... Yeah, it's a 225. It can't move on the first turn, so you're sort of stuck there. There's 2 very juicy targets there. Obviously, the HQs are worth points, so they're worth, I believe, 3 points for every HQ you get, and then 1 point for every artillery, and 1 point for every armor that you take out as well. Well, let me double-check that, actually. Say these things and I really should just look them up. Okay, yeah. For every Soviet HQ unit, you get +3 points. For every Soviet armor or artillery unit you kill, it's +1 point. For every German HQ unit that's killed by the Soviets, it's -2 victory points. And for every armor or artillery unit you lose as the Germans, it's -2 victory points. There's other like variable VPs you get. There's some things on the track, on the reinforcements track, that you can take for VPs. Like there's the 15 AM optional reinforcements, which include the activate any formation marker, which I'm definitely going to take. You just have to have it. Where's the other one? That's like a big one. Yeah, that's a pretty big one. There's also one up here, optional air units for 6 VP. They're only good air units you get in the game. As you can see here, the Germans start off with a fairly large air force. They're not quality planes, really, as you can see by their ratings, 4, 5, and 5. Certainly better than the Soviets there with just two planes at a four and a five. But if you get a cloudy turn, cloudy adds plus three to your die roll on trying to get these guys to work in close air support. So you can imagine if you get a four, it's a cloudy turn, and you're doing a mobile sequence, well, you have to spend points to get that roll to work. And we'll talk about that in a second. I didn't really go over using HQ points and command points to aid your die rolls, but it just becomes really tough. And in my last game, actually, I got so many armor attrition rolls when I was battling with my planes that I lost almost all my planes as the Germans. It was quite ridiculous. So that's another little thing about this scenario. As you play and use your planes, if you ever get an armor attrition result, you have to roll to see if the plane survives. And because so much of the air force for both sides is of poor quality, at least at five or four efficiency ratings, you lose those planes very quickly and very easily on an armor attrition roll. So that's something a little different that I didn't notice in the roads to Moscow scenarios. The roads to Leningrad scenarios, we're using the roads to Moscow air rules for it. I think I said that in the very first video. And the rules here for the air was way different. They had, like, if you see here, sort of offensive CAS missions remaining. Like, you can only have so many of those in a turn. And I believe there were, interceptor rules and fighter and bomber rules. It was interesting. It was a little complicated. And honestly, the way they handle air power in the Road to Moscow rules is just, it's way better. It's just easier to use. And you still get that feel, and you still have armor attrition that has planes go down. It's a really clever way to work it all in seamlessly, for a game that some people think has a lot of die rolls. It was a simplified way to do it. So, I tried playing the last game. This scenario, when I played it last time, I used the Road to Moscow air rules. Worked great. Not a problem. Pardon me. So, if we want to take a look here at the victory levels for scenario one and two, you'll notice a couple other things, right? So we have here, let me get that in focus here. German wins. So there's two victory times. There's 15 a.m. and 17 p.m. And there's a way for the German to get a sudden death victory at 15 a.m., which is the fifth turn of the game. It's difficult to do. I think you have to get, what, 24 victory points. Difficult to do. Most likely you'll be aiming for the 17 p.m., the end of the game victory point total, which is 28. And what's interesting about the game is, of course, that you kill HQ units and all that. Those are all fixed values from when you kill them, 3 points, 1 point. The cities actually change over time, so this actually is worth less than it is worth. Sitnia is actually, that's this town right here, Sitnia, is actually worth less in the first victory check than it is for the second. The second one's worth more because by then you're getting pushed back. And if you can actually hold that town after being pushed back by Soviet forces, that's worth points. So that's sort of the victory point determination. I've talked about the green locations. I guess I should show them to you in detail. So there's Sitnia, there's Soltsy, down here is Volot. It's down the southeastern part of the map. Not so easy to get to, but it can be done. And then there's the three around Shimsk. There's a couple cities up here. It's just this, I call it the little Shimsk triangle. And then, of course, there is Utrogorsk. There's Gorodishche. So those are our victory point locations we're shooting for as the German player. So Germans start first, they have the initiative. The weather stays clear, so we don't have to worry about any of that. And basically, we don't get to choose which formation goes first. I think in Roads to Moscow and a couple of them, you choose which goes first. We'll just have to draw and see what happens. And I guess we'll go from there.
Okay, so we're going to begin turn one. And since I haven't gone over the expanded sequence of play, I decided I should actually be official when trying to do this video because you might be wanting to see how this game actually really works in detail, or get to see just kind of the level of detail this game has. So we'll play by the books, kind of officially the first few turns, and then I'll probably like abbreviate some of this stuff later because I roll a lot of this together later in the game, the weather phase and an initiative and things like that kind of get put together, but let's go ahead and just do it here and be official. So the first thing you would do is the weather phase, and the scenario rules specifically state that the weather for turn one will be clear.
It can be cloudy, it can be rainy, and as you see, oh, I guess I should show you on the track here, you'll notice that there's numbers at the bottom. So the first turn says 1 through 10, the next turn on 13 p.m. it says 1 through 8, 9 through 10, and that means either clear, cloudy, and then as you see on the later turns, you can get rain. Rain is just really annoying in the fact that it takes more movement to get across the board on certain things, except for road. It also means you have to do, sorry, I'm totally bumbling the camera here. It also means you have to do things like only assault. You can't use mobile combat, and that can be a real bummer if you're the Germans and you're trying to make headway because mobile combat is the best way to do that. So we've already done the weather phase. The next phase that comes up is the reinforcement phase. And in Roads to Moscow, it uses a fuel system, so you might be able to see that rule there. It says, you resolve the fuel table supply or fuel supply table and then resolve fuel stuff. This game doesn't use fuel. It's one of the things I kind of miss. I wish it kind of did have the fuel component here, because what fuel did in the other game was you would choose whether or not you're going to. You got like a limited amount of fuel for the Germans, and at the beginning of your turn, you would choose to fuel that division or not, or that unit, the formation. If you didn't, they got low fuel effects, which reduced their movement. It also reduced their ER and some other things. So it definitely hampered them, and it definitely made you think, oh, when am I going to use fuel? When should I save fuel? It came on trucks, and you had to kind of bring it with you if you went off the supply road and kind of went on your own adventures because fuel was important. In this game, they didn't have that concept, and I do kind of miss it. But in a lot of ways, it's really refreshing to play it because in this way, you don't have to deal with thinking that kind of level. Like as a Germans, you just move ahead. You don't have to worry about that. I mean, in some ways, that's kind of not so great. In a lot of ways, it also is really refreshing. And takes less time and less worry. It's one less thing to think about. It's also one less thing to think about. So that has both positives and negatives for many people. So anyway, this is where the reinforcements come in. For the Germans, as you can see here, we only get those two units, and they only come in on the second activation of the third motorized. For the Soviets, we get the 21st Tank Division, and they can be on the east edge, any hex, or the north edge between a specific set of hexes, which I've marked over here. So let's kind of get a little plot view here. So you can either have them come here in the north and sort of take the northern road because this is sort of where the third motorized wants to push and take these sort of key cities, or you can take it and come across the east and do any hex here on the east. There's a couple of good ones. I'm not so worried about the south right now. Later I might be. Now I'm not. So probably it's going to be up here by Shimsk or this road down here. Probably. Okay, so here's the other things we got to think about. Let's take a look here. Let's put this down and let's actually look at some terrain. Oops. Okay. So as you can kind of see at the top, we have this main road coming out of Shimsk, and it comes up here, and then it sort of dives down here, and this takes you down to Soltsy. And then there's this southern road, the sort of minor road. And if we follow the minor road, we see that it sort of comes in on south of this major river here. Is it the Soltsy River? I don't know. I need to look that up. It's pretty bad. I don't know that, but I'll look that up. And what I mean is this sort of thicker line here. This is kind of considered a stream still. This is like a full-on raging river. Okay. Rivers affect zone of controls for motorized units. They don't get one basically across a river. It's also more difficult for them to move across a river. They have to spend their entire movement phase doing so. I believe. Let me double check that. But it's pretty bad for movement and purposes. And attacks across rivers are halved. So, and your attack strength is halved. And that's also a huge bummer. So you can kind of see that Soltsy here. If we get a little closer, oops, there. So if we look at Soltsy here, you can see that it has a river. Let's move these guys just a little over, just a little. So you can see here it's got this river here, and this is the victory hex the Germans need to take. So if you want to attack it, you can only wrap around units here and there, maybe here, but then you have to spend time sort of knocking units out of this hex. So at most, you're going to get here, maybe here, And then if you try to attack from here or here or... Well, actually not here because there's a bridge here. But here or here, then you're attacking through a river Hexide and half of your attack strength is automatically disappears. So it can be really difficult to take the town of Soltsy directly. It's difficult. So to really bring it back to my main point of the two roads, that southern road here that we could choose to put our 21st tanks on, as you see, it kind of comes down here, snakes across, and really forms sort of the southern part of this map, the southern part of the river. This front really is divided into two parts. You have your southern part and you have kind of the northern part of the river. And the southern part is a little more forested, lots more trails. It has this minor road, but curiously, if you look right here, this stream intersects the road. I don't know if that's a map error or if that's how they intended it to be. Because as you can see over here, by over on this part, the road is clearly cut here, and there's special bridging units you get that you can use on an assault turn. If your HQ is within four hexes of a desired hex, you can bridge it with a bridging unit. So you see you need a bridging unit here for sure to get across, to maintain this road, and that's important to help you get supply across this river to stay within supply. But here, I don't know if that's a map error or if that's intentional. When I played it last time, I didn't notice it until way later in the game, and it sort of gave the Germans a huge advantage because I was thinking that they had control of the road over here and they could bring supply up this road and they were supplying Soltsy. But then later I sort of ruled that, no, that river is cut, and because you have to use another bridging unit. The Germans, I believe, get two of them, so do the Soviets. So I ruled that I think you need to have a bridging unit here, otherwise supply sort of magically stops here if you've bridged it here and it's like comes up here and moves down, it's going to get stopped. Same thing with the Soviets, if they come this way and they have supply, it gets stopped there. Anyway, the southern road, it's just easier to get across, because if you notice, if you take this sort of northern road, there aren't any crossings. Like you can see, there's no way to get across here. The only bridge is actually down here at Soltsy. So that's why taking the northern or southern road, that was a very long explanation. But essentially, that's why it's an important choice, because it sort of dictates, well, are you going to be a northern dedicated front, a southern dedicated front? So the 21st tanks, you know, they're fairly powerful. I'm not, in this early stages, I have no idea what kind of movements the Germans are going to make, you know, whether or not they're going to be able to break through that area up there and then sort of continue on and put pressure on the south or the north. You know, I don't really know. Primarily, it looks like I'm totally afraid of getting the northern road busted. I mean, this is a very weak line of defense here. And once you get past that, it's just those guys. And they can't stack more than two. Remember those rules? Can't stack more than two in a space. So I'm inclined to put the 21st tanks because I just need bodies and I need some offensive power. I'm really inclined to actually put them down here. Pardon me. I'll put them in Chimsk and have them just roll out from there. The advantage is I might be able to get some of these army units that are machine gun units. I might be able to bring some of them with me. It never hurts to have extra bodies down the line. Sometimes it's good to leave those guys behind so that way in case the battle gets taken unexpectedly to the rear, at least you have one or two units there. But, you know, so I think we'll keep them there. So let's bring in the 21st tanks. All right, they get an activation to it. And I can put them on any eastern hex. So what we're going to do is we're going to have them come in here, okay? And when their turn comes in, they'll come in that way, because you actually have to pay the entry costs of the hex you enter on reinforcements. So not a lot really coming in for the Soviets here. If you take a look, what we got here, we got HQ, we got sort of an armored car. You know, I said this wrong, and I feel like a total dunce, because people actually do care about this stuff that play these games, that I got this the designation of that unit wrong. It is actually a motorized infantry. I might have called it mechanized. Nope, it's just motorized. So if it has little circles, it's motorized infantry. Fairly rare for the Soviets, so that's actually a nice little unit. And we also have just a sort of zero-value tank, which is also very rare, very nice to have. So not a whole lot of firepower here, but some one high moving factor, some good defense, and a free stacking unit. So you really can't beat that. That's actually not that bad at all. So when it comes time to do that, they'll get to move. And also because we got them, we get their activation token. So this is a good time to go over the next step of the sequence of play. So we did, let's see. So we don't have any units moved from the flown box to the ready box. This is when you would kind of recycle those. We don't need to trace supply. Well, we would, but everybody's in supply when the scenario begins. This is where you do the initiative phase, and we both roll a die, and you get certain DRMs if you make your opponent, retreat more than, or retreat 2 hexes in a battle, or you advance. Actually, I should say, you get DRMs if you advance more than 1 hex in a battle. That's pretty nice. Or if your opponent passes, because there is a way to sort of combine formations in this game and have two formations interact with each other. So if you pass, you give your opponent a die roll modifier later for initiative. Whoever is the first player, they can put all of their AMs, activation markers, into an opaque cup, and the second player can place up to the same number plus one. And this is where you get sort of strategy in the game, because you can put some of your units in reserve, and they actually come up later, and what that does is sort of increases the chances that a desired formation will come out of the cup sooner. Right now, as you can tell, the Germans sort of have their standard two formations, two activation markers per formation, and the Soviets get the 202nd, the 3rd tanks, and the 21st tanks. So not a lot to work with in the beginning for the Soviets, but that's the way the cookie crumbles, right? So into the cup they go. Let's get these guys. So let's get back to the center of the action here. Oops. I'm using this sort of octopus thing, and it is all jumbled now because I've been moving it all around. There we go. So let's go ahead and see who goes first. Oh, okay, this will be an easy one. Third motorized. So we'll put them in the activation pool. I could choose to combine this formation. Let's say I want to get a really powerful opening. That doesn't really make sense for the Germans. You pretty much want to strike hard, strike fast. There may come moments where you actually want to have the 3rd motorized and the 8th Panzer work in conjunction with each other. And what you do essentially is I would say, like, I want to do that. So I draw this and I'm like, pass. And if this was a face-to-face game, you actually keep this secret. You don't show the other player. And you would pass and you would hold on to it. And then next turn I would draw, and if I drew the 8th Panzer one, if I drew another 3rd motorized, I'd have to use it, because you can't combine two of the same ones. But if I drew the 8th Panzer one, then what I do is I say, okay, I'm going to combine my formations, and what you do is you roll a die, a 10-sided die. Everything's a 10-sided die in this game. You roll a 10-sided die, you add the value of, I believe, this formation. It might be the one you keep hidden, or you can choose. See, this one's a better one to work with. It's a 3. This one's a 2. You roll a die, you add this number on here, and if it's 8 or higher, then you can use both formations in the same turn. There are a couple restrictions on it. Essentially, you cannot coordinate your attacks unless, I guess, you're using an assault rule, or if the stack is moving, has units of both formations in it, which is kind of a weird rule. I assume it's just to kind of keep the gaminess down of using combined formations. It can happen, but it's just so much easier to keep your formations cohesive, as in their own formations, their own stack, because moving them around is just a lot easier. It's a lot easier to bring force to bear when they're all together. If you get kind of mixed up, then you can have units that get left alone when one formation advances or retreats, and it can leave you in some bad positions, some sticky situations. Anyway, we don't have to worry about too much for that now, because, like I said, as the Germans, you really just want to get go, go, go. So we're going to keep going here. We drew the 3rd motorized. The only 3rd motorized units I have on the board are right here. So my desired goal for them is to get to the north. I need to actually make this happen, because their goal is to go take. Well, so here's the thing, right? I have these Germans here, and I guess it's a good time to look at, like, what I actually have. So here's my initial. Here, let's bring you back up. Alright, so this is my initial sort of barrier up here. And my goal is to take this hex, right? And this unit can't move because of the special rules. These can, but this isn't firing. And if you look up there's a couple of units also up here. We kind of got an HQ that can't move, a motorized infantry that's, nothing to sneeze at, and something's got an anti-tank unit that has no offensive value, has some defensive value, and then another motorized up here. So if I want to get to Sitnia, One thing I have to keep in mind is sort of the attack and the bonuses and whether or not I can do mobile combat, things I'm thinking about. The one thing that immediately strikes me when I look at Sydney is this, is that we have streams and only one bridgeable hex. So that means if we want to attack across a stream, then we get a plus one to our roll, which is not good. We don't want any plus modifiers because higher rolls are bad in battle. So what I'm thinking is I want to put pressure on this unit to move. Also, it's in a city. Well, this one can't move, but these guys can. And it'd be really nice if I could pick off this tank, maybe this artillery unit, because it's actually worth a point and it can do nothing right now. So that'd be easy pickings. So something that moves me along this way and strikes up in the middle. So as 8th Panzer, I'll probably get a little bit more ability to do that. But as a 3rd Motorized, I'm also thinking, well, what can I do to sort of inspire those kind of movements as well? I put pressure maybe on this northern part because that is sort of the 3rd Motorized goal. If they could just run up and take Gorodishche and then deal with that unit, that's sort of what I did last game, and it was disastrous, but it was just poor rolls. I'm hoping that won't happen again. So let's go ahead and see what our 3rd Motorized buddy is going to do. Alright, and so the 3rd Motorized here is just a really powerful motorized infantry and an anti-tank unit. You'll get more motorized infantry, and they're just really good, but they come kind of in waves, and it's just not enough to really get a collective punch that you'd really like to have. And you'll also notice the anti-tank unit is orange circle. So they get stuck in Zox, they don't move as fast or as far. These guys are red box, and they're sixes, they're good. So let's see. Moving on trail when it's clear is half the cost of the hex normally. So clear hex is one, so it's one half. Moving through what they call trail and other is one. So this would be one, one and a half. Crossing a stream always costs one, but staying on the trail is only half a cost. So let's start moving this guy. Well, I ran out of video space there, so I guess we'll continue on with our movement here like we were saying. So let's go ahead and get ready to move these guys. So that's and one, or actually that's one, one and, crossing the stream makes it two and that's three, and four, and. And the reason I have to stop here at the four and not continue on is because this stack, as you can see, has that orange circle unit. So this is as far as it can go. It has four and a half. Oh, I guess I should have said that when I picked this chit, I need to decide if I was going to do an assault or a mobilized turn, and I chose mobile because I want to use the full movement. If I get into combats or do things, I'll get some die roll modifiers, but I don't think that's really going to happen this turn, and so yeah, I chose mobile. I kind of glossed over that when we did our operations segment. I chose mobile operations. So there you go. Anyway, so four and a half. Now, because these guys are red box, I can actually have them keep moving, because they can go one and a half MPs more, which would be just enough to cross the stream and go here, for example. They couldn't cross the stream and go here because that would cost two, one to cross the stream and then one to enter a trail and other hex. But they could go here, and that's actually not a half bad idea because I kind of want to start putting pressure on this hex immediately, if not to make him retreat, then just to know that I can demolish him practically in combat. I mean, two is not a great defensive factor. I don't have a lot of attack factors here. I have two, six, so I would get, let's see, was that 4-1? No, I'm sorry, 3-1. Did I say six? No, I have eight, so it would be 4-1. God, I'm really sorry. So it would be 4-1. It would have to be assault combat because I don't have an armored car or a armor unit that accompanies that. That's sort of the one drawback of the 3rd Motorized. There's actually only one unit they have that enables them to do... Actually, like, they have three. I'm looking at the reinforcements here. They have three units that can help them do mobile combat, but you'd only get one in the 14 a.m. turn, so two turns away, and then the other one show up at the 15 a.m. turn, which is on the fifth turn, so it's four turns away, I guess. So not too soon, not soon enough really to affect the fact that we're going to have to do assault combat on this position. But the other thing it lets me do is that it lets me put pressure on these guys. Because as you can see, if I cross that river and go here, then it's not a huge thing for me to go here and then snake down and come down and do that, or I can kind of come up here and come down on the trail. It would be nice if I went here because I would make this threat more plausible. and I could still have time to make this threat also actionable. Let me get a little closer so you can see what I'm saying. So, you know, I could have either way. And really, since I'm playing myself, I don't really surprise myself that often, right? When you're playing someone else, they may not know what you're trying to do. But in my mind, that's sort of a great way to put third motorized, because it gives the appearance, it gives me flexibility. If something magical happens with the 8th Panzer and they're able to totally demolish that unit, I won't worry about it, like coming down here and they win. If for some reason they get stymied and I need help, which I don't anticipate happening at all, that could be a viable response to take these guys and just motor down here. But anyway, it puts pressure on lots of fronts. I'm putting pressure in this open middle area. I'm probably going to come up here and seize that. And if I take him out, then that leaves a whole lot of country wide open for German, runaway German assault, or movement, I should say. And there's a victory hex up there. So let's not take those things while we can. So I think what I will do is take this HQ and the motorized infantry underneath it, and I will go ahead and cross that hex, enter that trail space, so that becomes 1.5, and that is its full movement. And that's all the units I have there, so that's the end of the third motorized turn. So we'll go ahead and put that over here, and we'll draw. Now we'll go to the Soviets, and let's draw and see what kind of shit they get. Alright, and they're going to draw... Was it the 202nd? Okay. So remembering that the 202nd's restrictions are that they cannot stack more than two units in a hex, I need to start thinking a few things. Should I begin my defense of Soltsy? As in the sense that should I begin... I can't build strong points either, which is a huge bummer. Otherwise I would take my turn and just start building strong points right now. But you can't do that. In fact, I can't do that until... Oh goodness, until 14 p.m. So two turns away, I have two turn restriction on building strong points. It just can't happen. The other thought is maybe I could start going down the road and helping out what inevitably will be an onslaught over here, because of course it looks like that position is very weakly held and the Germans can just sort of punch through it. Or I can sort of opt for some sort of middle line where I just sort of take a middle point of defense using these villages because they provide a natural plus one to battle, plus one die roll modifier, so a little bit of natural terrain cover to sort of help out. Or I could just begin really stacking and fortifying Soltsy and just hoping I can start throw some roadblocks up, maybe in the sense I can stretch my units across and just keep the Germans from either powering through or powering through. The northern route's a little more difficult because of all this forest terrain. But again, you know, like they said, the designers suggest that you just bypass Soltsy in the beginning with the 8th Panzer and just begin attacking Shimsk. So I'm gonna pause the video here. I'm gonna think about what I want to do, and then I'll come back and I'll show you what I actually decide to do. Okay, so I've sat here and I've thought about it, and here's the conclusion I've made. I would like to be able to move down this road and start helping out my friends down here in Sitnia, as we take a look there, and kind of motor down and begin helping them. But honestly, like, I don't have, my units aren't in a great position. It's going to take them way too much movement to get down the road, and they won't be able to do it in one activation. And that's all I get with these units this turn. The next turn, you know, I'll get one. The Germans, meanwhile, I'll get two per formation per turn. So I have to really think about the fact that they're probably going to be on me sooner than later. I'm not going to have the luxury of fast reaction time. So I need to really concentrate my defenses in a small area, or something that I can really reinforce quickly and enforce. So I wanted to go down here, but nothing could really make it up here except for my initial units up here. And since I can only stack two units anyway because of the restrictions, and I kind of want to bring this artillery because eventually it will be resupplied. So I think we're going to try to go for these towns here. And the big and little, what is that town? Zaborovye. Yeah, maybe. Honestly, I study Russian, and my Russian is so bad when I read transliterated stuff, it's terrible. If it was in Russian, I'd be able to read it really easily, but unfortunately when you transliterate in English, it becomes way more difficult for my brain to parse, as strange as that sounds. Anyway, so we're going to try to reinforce these towns, because if we can hold them, they give us natural defensive terrain modifiers, and it'll make it more difficult for them to go under, because there's no bridges here, and to cross streams takes a lot of movement. And also to go over, they'll have to hit a lot of forests and also our zones of control. It can still be done, but this is the best we can maybe hope for. So let's bring our units that are really far away into the fray. And one, and two, and three, and four. We'll take this one. It's one, and two, and we'll go ahead and put them up here, so it's three and. We'll keep the HQ back, because if they do break through, they're going to want to take it and kill it. So we're going to do and one, and two, and let's be really safe. Because HQs have a command radius of four. Let's get a little closer. What that means is that they get to, you see it has this number on the top, right? That number up there. That's the number of command points it can use to help certain roles, like your coordination checks, or if you have to do things like artillery checks or close air support. They can use their points and then add negative die roll modifiers to the roll, so it's easier to get the roll to coordinate. And they can do this within anything within four hexes for certain units they help, or for army units they want to summon to bring into battles, because they can command army units. Their range is four hexes, so you want to kind of keep them about four hexes away. All right, so who else do we have here? This guy. And one, and two, and I'll put him here. And then this guy will come out of Soltsy and reinforce that part. Keep him there, and then we'll bring this artillery unit who's all the way, oh, you can't see him. He's down there in the forest. So what we'll do is we'll go one, two, because you've got to cross the stream and enter a trail and other hex. That's two, and three, and four, and we'll keep him back here. I probably should be more careful and move them further back down the line, but I just don't think the Germans will be that quick in getting back there that fast. Because that would be a very tempting target. An HQ and an artillery unit, that's four victory points right there. So we'll go ahead and keep the 202 there. I've got two in each stack, so we're doing the best we can. And so their activation is done. All right, let's see who comes next on the Germans. All right, it's the 8th Panzer. So we're actually going to come down here and look at these guys. So let me take a look at the thing, and then I'll come back and we'll talk about 8th Panzer. Okay, so let's take a look at what we have in the 8th Panzer, because they come with a lot more forces on the board than the 3rd Motorized begins with. And they're actually going to be, as their name suggests, our armor force. It's going to have a lot more of the Panzers located here. So we got a couple of motorcycle cavalry there, motorcycle. Actually, a couple of those. Let's see what else we got here. We got a couple armored cars, and what is that unit? That's a very interesting. It looks like an anti-tank, but it's got that circle on it. I'm gonna have to look in the other book to see what that is. So I'm sure some viewer will know, and they'll be like, oh, don't you know that's like anti-tank reconnaissance or something? You know, it's going to be something crazy, so. It's hard to get focus on that. Anyway. There we go, 1-6. Anyway. So, that's there. So, not a really powerful force. I think, what do we have here? A total of 2, 4, 6, 7... See here, 1, 2, yeah. So it's 6, 8. So all we have is 8 there. We can actually do a mobile attack with them because of that armored car, even though it's a weak armored car, they can do mobile attacks. And the other stack here that we have our HQ is actually a much more potent and powerful stack. This is where we're actually going to get some of our panzers out. And that's actually, these are very nice. They're all one stacking. Got some anti-air there. Another anti-air unit. Actually, 3 anti-air units. So here's really the core. I mean, this is where you start seeing a lot more of the power, because we have these sort of armored units that only have one stacking value, a lot of power, 3, 6, 9, 10, 11, 12 right here. So what do we have? So 20 total factors of power by them. It doesn't seem like a lot, but remember, these guys can do mobile attacks as well, and that's very helpful. All right, so we're back there. Back to where we started. Actually, I moved those guys around, and I'm hopefully putting them back in the same hex. These guys should be in 31, 29. They are. The other guys are in 29, 26. They are. Okay, good. You get kind of paranoid sometimes. You're moving things around and you're focusing and talking, and you kind of forget where you put guys. Now you understand how mistakes are made. So the focus is blowing through here. And honestly, this guy can't move. This guy's ineffective. This guy can combat react. He could kind of run away if he wants to, or react to help somebody else move. I would ultimately like to take him down, and I'd also like to grab a free VP by killing this guy. And if there was some, and then either I can plow through there and keep going, or try to figure out if I'm going to try to tackle this guy over here, because he looks like some free, easy points. He's all by his lonesome, and we don't like their high-powered units getting together. It makes them tougher to kill. So I think what we're going to do is we're just going to focus on maybe trying to take out that tank there. I think that's going to have to be maybe our goal, mostly in that artillery. We'll see what we can do here. Let me take a look, and I'll be right back. Okay, so something you won't see because it's now in the trash can of my computer is the previous attack file in which I had the 8th Panzer conduct some illegal overruns. I haven't discussed overrun in this game yet. I did in the last recorded video, which you won't know about. Essentially, overrun is something that can only be done by units with red box movement only. And as you can see, this entire stack is red box movement, so they are overrun capable. You also have to have an armored car or an armored unit or cavalry. In this case, the motorcycle cavalry does not count as cavalry. They're actually like motorcycle infantry. But the, where is that armored car? There he is. The armored car is right here, allows it to do overrun attacks. It also allows this stack to use mobile attacks as well. So originally what I did was I took this stack and I motored them up here and I overran this hex here. And it was to good effect because then I was able to take these units, move them up here, and then do a double attack on the tank here. Unfortunately, you can't do that because overruns cannot be conducted from a hex in multiple enemy zones of control. So I was actually attacking from here to there. It's under that zone of control from that unit, and this unit as well is exerting a zone of control here. So if I could have gotten over here, I could have overran that direction and have been fine. If I'd have been somehow over here, because the artillery unit does not exert a zone of control, that's what that yellow band means. I could have overrun all the situations. As it is, you cannot overrun. I mean, I could have run this tank unit with these guys. I would take a +2 modifier to my final roll, a negative modifier, even though it's a positive one, it's higher numbers are bad in this battle system, because I'd have to cross a stream to do so. So instead, I've looked at it over and over, and while it would be nice to overrun, because overrun is in the movement phase, and it does not allow your opponent to use combat reaction, or no retreats, or get close air support, among other things, it's just a really handy attack capability to have. It's not always easy to do, because it costs an extra movement point in addition to what it takes to get there. So overrun is a really handy option. Unfortunately, I just don't have the right amount of movement to pull it off the way I want to here. I mean, I thought about taking some tanks out of this stack and just having them combine with some of the motorcycle guys here and just blitzing through, but there just isn't enough movement points to do all that. So what I'm going to have to do instead is a somewhat less effective attack, but still very offensive-minded. So I'm going to take these guys, and they're going to go and 1, 2, because of the +1 for zone of control, 2.5, 3.5, because of the zone of control effect again from that unit and this unit. And it's going to stop there. And if you remember, only red box units can power through zones of control, right? So all these guys were red box, so they could actually power through after getting stuck here. This stack, because it contains orange box or orange circle units, they're going to get stuck. So it's and 1. Wait, why am I getting all those guys? All right. And 2, and 3, 4, because of the zone of control effect. And they couldn't have gone here even if they were orange circle, because that would be 4 and 5 and, because of the additional one there. So they're stuck there. So what we can do here is actually two different mobile attacks. I won't put these markers down all the time, but just so you know, I'm doing a mobile attack from here to the tank, and from this group to the motorized infantry there. This infantry cannot move, so it can't do a combat refusal. It would probably like to, it's not going to be able to. What it could do is it could have, this unit is also being attacked, so I think it's going to combat refuse and try to get away, because this tank is actually a zero stack unit. It's actually not too bad. Let's get a little closer so we can actually make out the Okay. So we're going to do two mobile attacks on the diagonals there. This one's going to take a plus one penalty because it's crossing a stream without a bridge. As you can see here, there's no bridge there. This one will not because there is a bridge there. So we'll go ahead and do this one first. So first thing we do, we look at the initial odds. Well, you don't actually calculate the initial odds at first. What you'll do first is you'll say, okay, do we want to bring in any close air support? And the way you do that is you sort of take these planes, I think I've talked about this before, and you try to roll the efficiency roll number, and if you get it, you get a die roll modifier. If you don't, it doesn't have any effect. I'm actually not going to use any planes on this segment from the Soviet or German perspective because I just don't think it's the right time. And honestly, the Soviets only have two planes to use or two air wings to use. The Germans have four, so the Soviets have to be really cautious right now in using their air power, and I just don't think it's a good time to use it. So after you do close air support, then you decide, are you going to use artillery? The defender goes first. Well, the defender can't use their artillery. It's already fired. The attackers have no artillery right now to use, so we're going to skip the artillery step. And then you go through, let me take a look at the actual order. All right, so now we do the attacker unit strength. This is where we do coordination rolls. So for this first battle, we know we have 8-2. And that comes out of 4-1. And we don't do a coordination roll here because it's a mobile attack, but it's only coming from one hex. All the units are of the same formation and they're not disrupted. So there's no coordination check here. We don't have to worry about that. So now we look at sort of terrain modifiers and figure out our final die roll modifiers for this battle. So the first thing we look at is we say, okay, Sydney is at a village. That means that that motorized infantry gets a plus one to its role because of the village, defensive terrain. The next thing we look at is efficiency rating. So I kind of forgot to say that we have to pick out a point unit whenever you do a battle for the defender, and the attacker has to. For this case, the defender has to be that motorized infantry. For me, I'm not going to use my armored car because it's kind of one of a kind. I really need it to do mobile attacks. Instead, I'm going to have this sort of motorcycle, I guess it is motorcycle infantry, I don't know, it's motorcycle unit. I'm going to have it go first because it has a really good action rating or efficiency rating of 7. And it's also expendable. If I lose it, I don't lose the ability to conduct mobile attacks. I just lose a very handy unit that moves fast and has a high rating. So what you do is you compare the two and you take the difference. So I have 7. And the Soviet player has 4. So that's a minus, that's a 3 difference, and that comes as a minus because I have the, as the attacker, you want to get negative numbers. So, we'll actually do this so I can get the full calculations viewed. So we get a minus 3 ER check. And then the one other thing you check for is combined arms bonus, and that's a minus 1 DRM if your attacking force has an armored unit and one or more units of motorcycle, motorized infantry, engineer, or recon. The defender can't have a red defense strength unit or be located in a town strong point or fortified hex line. I don't have any armor attacking with this stack, so I don't get the combined arm bonus. An armored car does not count as armored. So we've done all of our bonuses here, so it comes out to a negative 2 die roll modifier. At 4-1 odds on the mobile table, so we're going to roll. 10. And so we take a 10 and we subtract 2 from that. And what we get is 8. And an 8 on the 4-1 combat table is defender retreat. So, you know, we were kind of hoping for some losses, didn't really get what we want, but they still are moving. So we'll move them back. Okay, so the defender actually gets to choose here because on overruns, the attacker chooses where you go with some rules. They can't do bad things for you. Like they can't run you through enemy zones of control because that causes potential step losses. But if it's just a regular attack and you're forced to retreat, then the defender chooses. And actually, I will just retreat up the road. Let's just keep going back up the road because there's fallback positions there, bring me closer to Soltsy and whatnot. As the attacker, I have the option of moving up to 2 spaces. And I will, because that gives me a modifier for initiative next turn as well. So I will go here, and I'm going to keep the pressure up. I'm going to go there, actually. So now that's one attack resolved. And I get a plus one modifier for my initiative roll. Because anytime you do an attack and you're able to advance 2 hexes, you get a plus one modifier. You're like getting better tempo. You're pushing the enemy back. All right, so let's do this other attack. Alright, so we have 12 attack factors. Well, first we'll look at this and say, are we going to use planes? Again, not going to use planes. Are we going to use artillery? Not going to use artillery. Do I have to do a coordination roll? No, because this is only one stack, they're all the same formation, and they're not disrupted, so I don't do a coordination roll. So now we do the calculations and the DRMs. So we know that we have 12 attacking factors to 3 defense factors, which is again a 4 to 1. I'm attacking across a stream, that's plus 1 for stream. He does not have any defensive terrain, it's clear. And my lead unit for this attack will be one of my anti-air units, so it has a 6 rating. So we'll go ahead and pull him on top. So that's a minus 2 difference in efficiency rating. Okay. I think that's it. There's no other modifiers. Yep. So this becomes a minus 1 modifier total. So let's go ahead and roll and see what we get here. Another mobile attack, 4 to 1. I did it again. Rolled another 10. All right. On a 4 to 1, a 10 is, with a minus 1 die roll modifier, is a 9. That is a defender retreat with, unfortunately, an armor attrition result. So this is actually the worst. So I can retreat. I can't go there because I would have to take, I'd be in a zone of control. You can't end up in a zone of control, or you become eliminated. So I have to retreat 2. I will go 1, 2. This guy will advance, and then because it was mobile, he can do 2. He'll go here. Now here's where the bummer comes in. It's a defender retreat, so not a big deal. We don't take any losses. The defender runs away. You know, it's another, you live to fight another day. Unfortunately, it was an armor attrition roll, and that means I have to take, even if I don't take a loss as an attacker, I have to take a loss in armor when an armor attrition comes up. And in this case, the attacker did have, actually, he did not have a red defense. Do I wonder if I have to use that then? Let me look at that. 11.23. So we're just gonna. That's one of the nice thing about filming videos is that you get to look up rules and see if you're correct in your memory or not about what happens here. Okay, results printed in red on both CRTs require an armor loss if the attacking force contains one or more armored seps and if the defending hex are armored or have a red defense strength. So he was armored, that means he can do armor attrition. That sucks. So what's going to happen is I'm going to lose one step off one of my armored units. Ah, brutal. Brutal not only because it sucks to take step losses so early, but that also I lose 2 victory points for that. I'm now a negative 2. So yeah, I got off to a great start as the Germans. What's funny is I did that overrun turn and the exact same thing happened. I basically got an armor attrition result, and I had to lose an armored step. So it's happened again. So yeah, way to go. Way to go attacking Germans. Okay, so that was the end of the 8th Panzer's turn there. So now we're going to see who comes up next for the Soviets. And it's going to be the 3rd Tanks. And that was the force I was just pummeling. So just to give you a little brief overview, there they are. You can kind of see them in a line there. That's starting all the way down here. There he is there. And moving all the way up here is 3rd Tanks. So I'm gonna need to think about what I can do. This guy can't move. That guy can't move. So yeah, and there's that guy up here, I forgot. He may actually just hold up there and try to block supply. So we'll see. Let me take a look at what I'm gonna do and get back to you. Okay, so I looked over the 3rd Tanks options, and honestly, they're not great. This force is just too mangled and not gonna be able to withstand the 8th Panzer or making a direct attack on the 8th Panzer. I think the fact that these units up here weren't even took step losses and got away with just retreats is fairly lucky. So what I want to do is I want to consolidate. I want to grab these forces together and I want to do so in a way that's going to let me, you know, have flexible defense, but also still put a roadblock in front of the Germans. Hopefully something that's a little more or a little more difficult to push aside than what was there before. So I think I'm going to center on this town. I'm going to go up here. And the reason is it's the closest town I can get this tank up to and still have a town to stop in, because it does give me that plus one DRM in combat. Not an overrun, but in combat. I'm trying to minimize overrun risks here, but I'm also trying to maximize my defensive value in combat. So let's go ahead and show this is going to work out. I'll move these bottom units, and then we'll address sort of the northern elements of the third tanks. So just so we can get a better camera angle, let's move this guy. He's going to go and one, and two, and crossing this will be a 1-2 because it's crossing a river and it's a clear hex. So we were 2-and here, so 3-and, 4-and, 5. So this is the most he can actually go is up to this, is up to, almost lost it there. That's the furthest he could go. Okay, so where else are we going to do these guys? Well, obviously this person's just going to spend one movement total to get back there. This tank will go 1-2-and, okay? I could have done other things, but I'm just showing you how the movement works. And here's a good example. So this guy is trapped. Remember, he can't go through zone of controls where he gets stuck. So we're going to have to go and, because it's trail. So that's 1, because it's trail and other. So 1-and, 2-and, 3-and, 4-and, 5. I think I did that right. You know how it is. You're looking at the camera and miscounting. The biggest thing is I want that artillery kind of further away. So let's actually double count and make sure we got that right. So it was over here. So it's and, 1-and, 2-and, 3-and, 4-and, 5. Okay, so we did get it right. What does this allow? Well, I've got here now 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Wait, that's not right. Or 9, what was I thinking? I have 9 defensive unit factors there, which is great because we know that the combined total of these two is just 20. So the most they can get is a 2-to-1 attack. And an overrun, they couldn't even get a 2-to-1 because these guys don't count because they have the orange box movement. So without these guys, their total attack power is 17. So not enough to do a 2-to-1 overrun. They could get a 3-to-2 odds, but those aren't that great. So, you know, I'm fairly secure here. It's not totally impregnable. It's definitely, it cannot withstand much more of an assault, but at least it's one more point and some little a little area to slow down the German advance of the 8th Panzer. Now, up here, I made a mistake earlier. I think, let me get this back up so we can actually see what we're talking about here. I made a mistake. So I said that, like, a unit down by, in the south, that they couldn't move, like, down on what was the town we just took? Insignia. Was that right? Yeah, Insignia. I thought there was a unit there that couldn't move. Actually, what it was is I misplaced a unit. There was this motorized infantry, and I had him down here. He really should have been up here with HQ, and both these units cannot move during this turn. So it just, they can't do anything. They gotta sit there. So I need to be boosting their defense. And the only unit that can get there is this guy, and it's lucky he even survived, because usually he gets wiped out pretty quick. So we're going to go ahead and do and one, and he's just going to join this circle, or this hex here. They've got a village under it, and this now provides 3, 4, 5, 6 total factors of defense. Again, not a ton, but the third motorized isn't rolling too deep anyway. It's only got 8 attack factors here. So this is a pretty good force to stop them. And in the far north, I'm going to take this unit that I've just sort of left up there. And then last game, I just moved him over to that supply point and just held it. I think this game, I'm going to have him go over and actually hold Gorodishie and actually make that a pain because that's a VP hex. So we're going to do and one, and two, and three. I'm going to remove that. I know that's a victory hex. I would keep those out there, but it's really just a visual aid to know where you're at, and I know where the early hexes are anyway. Okay, so now you can see we're kind of getting those lines shortened up here. Now we can kind of begin to see how it looks going down the road there. You can kind of see what the Germans have in store, what they have to go through and overcome. Nothing too crazy yet. Luckily, the 202nd can't build strong points. That really helps them out there. Okay, so that was the third tank's turn. Let's see who's next. Oh, it's our friends, the third motorized. Okay, so back to these guys. Okay, so as we can see, take the wide view here. The Gordiche at the top here, that's their victory point hex. These guys can't move and they're tempting, but now it's 3, 4, 5, 6, and all I have is 8 attack factors. Oh, I forgot though, we do get reinforcements. It's our second activation. All reinforcements come through the southern hex here. So here they go. We got ourselves another motorized infantry and some artillery. That's very helpful. So we'll go ahead and move them. Because I need them to go far and I need to do things, we're going to call this a mobile sequence, not an assault one. So I got my full MA. Looks like I have a 5 and a 6 here. So let's go ahead and just go as far as a 5 can go and maybe throw the 6 up a little further. So watch how we're going to do this now. We're going to go and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 5. That's where he stops. And then I'll take this guy and go and 6. And you can see I can kind of take this road and I can snake up here. And if we do a little pan up, you can see that little cutoff there will give me access to this bridge, lets me go off on these trails and take off different places. So I can hopefully very quickly get up there. Maybe, obviously not this activation, but next turn maybe I'll be able to go help out on that attack. So the third motorized, what to do? What to do? I really would like to kill that HQ, but these units just aren't going to get there fast enough. And it's just, that's going to be kind of, Oh, this is a tough one. So I think what I'm going to do is, man, assaults just aren't great either. Because I'd have to do an assault. I can't do mobile attack with these guys. I don't have their armor unit. There's only one armor unit for the third motorized. Rough. But I think I will go to the north. We'll just leave these guys here. I can't really effectively attack them. I won't be able to do anything but harass them. I mean, I just don't have the firepower yet. And even when I get this other motorized infantry in, it's just not going to be enough. So I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go on and we're gonna try to take on this lone unit up there, and if we can, maybe just motor down that road and grab that victory hex and make them a little worried about what's going on. So let's go ahead and do that. Let's go ahead and move them up this road, and I think we'll try to go this way. It sounds like a good path. So we got 1 and 2, 3 and 4 and 5 and that's as far as they can go. And these guys will come with them. Oh yeah, he's stuck on the other side of the river. Oops. Oh, that's gonna be a bummer. Don't really want to open myself up to counterattack, but these guys aren't probably gonna bring it. They're only just a 4. Yeah, that's not really gonna be worth it. So we'll do 1, 2, because one across the river, or actually 1.5. So it's 0.5 for being on trail, one for crossing over, 1.5. 2.5, 3, 3 and 4 and 5. So yeah, he can go there. So he can get kind of close. Yeah, we'll see if this really pays off. This is the tough choice. Do you actually try to cut these guys off, or do you just go up there and we'll see. The 21st tanks have not come on yet. They will come up next, and I do have the option of moving them up here and reinforcing them to the north, which would just be like a nightmare for those guys. But honestly, this is such a nightmare here that I think I really need to bring the tanks in as I planned coming over there. So let's go ahead and draw their chit and just move them. Because I know they're the last chit. 21st tanks. And we'll just go ahead and move them in because they need to get cracking. So the tanks, unfortunately, are slow. The HQ's got a 6, but we have a 5 motorized infantry. 7 armor car is pretty good. But a 4 other tank, which is not bad. So let's go ahead and try to move as far as the 4 will take us. So that's and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. So we'll drop off our little guy there. And 5. Drop him off. Okay, I'm not doing a good job here. And 6 and 7. Alright, so we're kind of strung on the road there. Oh, you didn't even see the other ones, did you? Sorry. Totally took that out of camera angle there. So you can kind of see we're strung along the road there. But we're getting closer to Soltsy. And that's pretty much all that's pretty much all they can do. That was all they had turns for. So let's activate the very last one, which is going to be, of course, the 8th Panzer. And let me bring us back here to the 8th Panzer. All right. Let me think about what I want to do with these guys and come back. Okay, so once again, I've thought about what I'm going to do with the 8th Panzer here. And as much as I try to figure out a way to do it, there's no way I can understand to get past this guy and go zap that artillery. There's no way he exerts his own control around all these hexes, and I just don't have enough movement to power through. And I honestly should probably be going for this HQ up there and getting that unit, because I can definitely reach it with these guys and go attack. But it's a little bit of a diversion. I mean, this is technically, what, three? There's 3 points there, but it's also a stack that's 3, 4, 5, 6. This is a 7. What is that? 4, 5, 6, 7, 9. So there's 9 points here. But like, taking down this armor unit, getting rid of some of these guys, I mean, there's some good units here. There's 2 armor units, that's 2 points. There's, you know, motorized infantry, that's definitely worth getting rid of. And it leaves this artillery here, and it would put them more on the back foot if I can just keep the tempo. Because my goal is to get to Soltsy really before people get organized and before the 70th especially gets into action. And the 21st tanks will be barreling down there as fast as they can. So I think my goal here is to attack this little roadblock here and ensure that I can at least move it or get it to go or do some damage to it. And one of the ways I can do that is surrounding it with zones of control, so that when it has to retreat, it will at least have a chance of taking the loss. And so how am I going to do that? Well, I'm going to take this tech here. I'm going to go and, because and on the road. This is where it gets kind of weird. It's going to cost me 2 movement points to go here. You would think it'd be half. But since I'm not using the road to go through this hex and to go to that hex, and I'm going to go over here, I have to use the other terrain cost. I'm not using the road to its natural contour. So, like, there's a half, but this costs 1 plus 1 for the zone of control, so that's 2. And then I'm going to go over 1 more. That's 2 more movements. So we had and, so that's 2 and. This will be 4 and. I guess I could go get this. Ooh, let me think about that for a second. Hold on. Okay, I'm back, and I thought about it, and honestly, I could expend 2 more movement points, so I was here. So it's and, 1, 2, and, 3, 4, and. This would be 5, 6, and. But then I could just go right here and do 7 with these guys, and this guy doesn't have a zone of control, and then attack there, and have a pretty good shot at just destroying that and getting a free point. But any points I take away from here, there's only 20 total, and I need to get at least 2 to 1. Oh, that is so tempting to do a 2 to 1 attack. I could peel 1 unit off here and go attack this. But 2 to 1 assault odds, because I couldn't do a mobile combat, are not great. You can get messed up pretty quickly as the attacker on those. Oh, it's just, it's really tempting, and I hate to not be adventurous. I think I am going to do this, just for the sake of the video. Sometimes I'm a little too cautious. Let's get adventurous. We're going to have this unit go over here. He's going to be able to make it. He'll go there. And that leaves us with just enough. I have 2. So that leaves us 2, 4, 6 here. That's right. And that leaves us 12 here, so there's 18. Okay, perfect. So what we're going to do here is that these guys are going to go and 1, 2, 3, because they're going up there. Since they're orange circle units, they're going to get stuck. And these guys are going to power through, because they actually have red box 6 movement, so that was what? And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So they can go there. Okay. The only thing is that gives me more difficult to do coordination rolls. Is it worth trying to guarantee a hit for retreat? to get more coordination. Yeah, I think we'll do that. So here's what we're going to do. Two different attacks. We're going to use this guy. He's going to come up here and just do an assault attack. That's going to be kind of risky, but we're going to pull it off anyway if we think we can. And then these are all going to be mobile attacks on that guy. Shit, I wish I could just... I could have sent this guy over to do it one-to-one mobile. Oh, this is tough. A one-to-one mobile, unfortunately, and that guy's like... nice armored car. Is this even worth doing a 2-to-1 attack? Now I'm reconsidering if I should be doing this. Is this an assault? So yeah, I mean, I'd have to roll pretty badly. I think we're gonna do it. We're gonna live dangerously. So let's do the assault combat first. So, okay. This is one combat I think the Soviets will use a plane on. They will try to bring a plane in. So we'll first do close air support. And because this is my last attack, we'll go ahead and bring in our own plane too on that attack. So we'll just roll two die. And we'll see who can get their plane. So because it's a mobile, we get plus one to our rolls. Well, wouldn't you know it? Soviets get their plane, Germans do not. That's really going to help them. That sucks kind of now. There's no artillery to call in, so we can't do that. And we don't have to worry about coordination, because assault, you never have to do coordinated assault if it's all at the same formation. So we're totally good there, no coordination necessary. So then we do sort of defensive checks. He's not in a village. So let's see, we have 2-to-1, literally. He gets plus one for close air support. He gets minus three for... the efficiency rating differential, because I have a 7, he has a 4. So I get a 3. That comes out to be a negative 2 to the roll. Okay, so we're going to roll this die. Oh yeah, that's what I'm talking about. A 2. 2 minus 2 is 0. That's bad news for this artillery unit. So even on an assault table, that is a defender 2 retreat. So he actually dies, and we get a point. Yay! We're down to negative one VP. Kind of ridiculous. Okay. Well, that paid off. He could advance if he wants to. You know, let's not get too far ahead of our guys here. Let's just kind of kick it there. I don't want to get too close to these guys, even though they might reach out and try to kill that dude. I don't know. Maybe not. Probably not. But let's just be cool. Let's just be cool and not advance. Stay cool. Okay, so, that also was not an armor attrition result, so none of these planes have to get checked, so those get flown. Now we go to the main event here, this combat. We do the same thing. They're going to bring their plane in. Woo! They're 4. I'm going to bring in my plane. I'm going to roll 2 die again, adding 1 because of the mobile. Nobody gets their planes. We got a 7 and a 9 here. No, that's not a 1, that's actually a 7. So nobody gets their planes. Boo-hoo. There's no artillery. Oh, wait. They could have combat refused. So I did all that stuff, and really what I should have done is think, oh, wait, can the units do anything? So can they do anything? Could they combat refuse? They could combat refuse. They have all red box, and I believe that's pretty much, I don't think there's any other restrictions. Let's take a look here. No unit can be disrupted, and they must all be red box and mayor cavalry. They are, so we're going to go ahead and see if they can do it. They have really crappy ER ratings, and they don't get it. They get an 8. So they don't get to combat refuse. There's no reaction movement. There's nobody that can help them out. They could do a no retreat, because... well, actually, can they do no retreat? To do no retreat, you must have at least 3 sets of strength, have not failed combat refusal. Oh, we did try to run away, so that's not going to work either. But we'd also need either a strong point, a fortified line, or a formation HQ or leader there. We don't have any of those, so he actually can't do any of that. So now attack has to go down. So we did our close air support. Nobody worked. We don't have any artillery to throw in. No artillery. Here's where we're going to do combat coordination. We're doing a mobile attack. But we're doing it from more than one hex, so we automatically have to check. Our die roll modifiers are plus one because it's mobile, and plus 2 because we're attacking from 3 or more hexes. Okay, so I'm going to use this guy here. He's my little HQ guy. He has those 2 command points. You can use command points to affect die roll modifiers on coordination, artillery strikes, and close air support. I think that's all you can use it for. And they get replenished at the end of each turn, so, you know, there's a lot more HQ for the Germans, so that's another advantage they have, just more command points to use. So I'm going to roll a die, and I'm going to pick my lead unit for this combat is going to be one of the motorcycle guys, of course. So you got a 7. I'm going to get the plus 1 because it's a mobile to the roll, and then minus 2 for those command points. So it's a negative 1 total. I'm going to roll my die. Look at that, a 7. So we pass. If we had failed our combat coordination roll, then I would get a plus 2 to my final battle roll, which is not great. Okay, so now we're on to our final modifiers. He is sitting, I believe, in a village, right? Yeah, he's in a village. That's plus 1. Plus 1 for village. I'm using a 7, and the highest rated guy they have here, I believe, is a 4. Yeah, they're going to use that motorized infantry as their lead unit. So I get a minus 3 ER differential. I believe I don't get a combined arms bonus here. Must not have red defense strength. Do you have red defense strength? Nope. So actually I can get a combined arms bonus because I have both armor and motorized infantry and motorcycle infantry attacking. So I get a minus 1 DRM for combined arms bonus. That's actually very helpful. I'll do one there for combined arms bonus. So I get a total of minus 2 to my roll. All right, so this is... Oh, we never did the calculating the odds. I'm so stupid. Of course, since we sent 2 units over there, we're going to have 18 to 9. So this is a 2 to 1 combat with a minus 2 roll. 10. Holy, holy, holy. Not quite what we wanted, but it'll work. So at a 4 to... or a 2 to 1... A 10 becomes an 8. Ugh, that's not what we wanted. Boo. That's not what we wanted at all. Attacker 2, defender 1, and it's armor attrition. Boo. Oh, that sucks. Not getting what we need here. So another armor unit is taking a hit. Lose another 2 VPs. Down to negative 3. This is kind of ridiculous. And I have to lose this guy. Because I lost, had to lose 2. So he goes away, because he was the lead unit. So normally the lead unit would go first, but because it was armor attrition, I had to take that unit out. Man, I just cannot believe I got that. Okay, so defender takes 1, and that was their motorized guy. And he's gone. He's a one-stepper, so he's out. I don't get any points for him, though. That was very frustrating. That was not a good battle for me. That happens, right? I mean, that's the nature. You sometimes think, you know, 2-1 is not great. On mobile, usually you get a lot more of, like, moving guys around, getting retreats a lot more often. Unfortunately, I just rolled really high numbers, and that was not good. And that was an armor attrition, so we gotta roll for planes. Alright, let's see if any of these planes make it. We got 2 dice. This time you don't add anything, you just do a quick roll. And actually, the German plane survives. Yay! Roll a 4. Soviets lose their plane. Not good for them. German plane survives. Okay, so that was the end of that. So that wasn't exactly what we wanted. We did get our artillery kill over here. We did not do what we wanted to over here, which is push them around. And they actually did a lot of damage to us. That was a negative bad attack for us. Really good for the Soviets so far. Really doing some super damage. 8th Panzer. I think my last game, 8th Panzer didn't take a single armor step loss. So I've already lost 2. Like, they're they're getting fragile. So let's take a look at the board. That's the end of turn 1. Let's get this little light. I have this light on because it's a little dark in my... I live in Portland, Oregon, so it gets dark. So that's sort of the board as we have it now. You can kind of see, sorry about that glare over there, you can kind of see the units coming in up here. Oh, there is my finger. slowly along the road to Soltsy. Got the units blocking here. Third tank, they've done heroic work here. They're going to suffer losses, but heroic work nonetheless. Third motorized coming up the road. Third motorized moving up here. So lots of stuff that's going to happen. If we look ahead to next turn, I think we're going to see that for 13 p.m. you get some more of the 21st tanks are going to come in, some bridging units, and more air force. That's good. But for the Germans, it's an amazing turn. 13 p.m. gives them all this row of units here. Oh, man. So a lot more of the 8th Panzers coming in, and we get our leader. Oh, it's going to be good. Glorious fun. So even though we've had some minor setbacks here, hopefully we can continue going on and barreling through, because it's still very, very weak defenses in front of Soltsy. All right, so that's the end of turn one. When you come back, we'll start doing... let me take a look at the... I see that's the end, and we should actually check the sequence of play. Okay. So we've done all of our markers. Now what we do is the engineering phase. We would complete all strong points that were being built. They would be completed. We remove enemy strong points from any hexes that are occupied by non-disrupted combat units. We then can remove disruption from units that are not in enemy zone of control. And if they're disrupted and in a zone of control, you make an ER check. We remove all of our little markers. We turn people back over to their full. I believe as long as they're in supply, they can do all that. And then we do a victory check, and then we do a turn phase, and we start all over again. And move to turn two, check for weather and initiative. All right, so that's turn one of Roads to Leningrad, the Soltsy scenario, and onward to turn two.